So you ready to get back into some training? Good, because this one's going to be the second part of drawing walls and room components. In the first one, I wanted to show you just the basics of adding walls to your project, since that is usually one of the first things we need to do before placing cabinets, and also some of the things to be mindful of when you're laying out your jobs. We want to make sure that we're being as efficient as possible and not needing to go back and redo things because something happened that we didn't expect. And the first series of videos is really just all about that and laying down the foundation. I want to make sure that you're getting a good understanding of how this software works and how it's designed to be customized and set up to meet your standards. After a little practice and doing some work on your own, I'm sure you have a good feel for how to draw walls, so this one will be short, but I do want to just go through a couple exercises and show you some of the things that you can do to be sure everything in your project is as accurate as possible. So that's the plan for this next session of training. Let's get back into it and keep learning more about Toolbox. So we're back inside of the MPU Walls and Room Components project. Open room one, new walls. So in this room, we learned how to draw walls from our library using some of the basic commands that we have. So now we're going to take it a little bit further. We're going to learn how to add some more obstructions to these walls and other ways that you can modify them to make sure that they're matching with what you need to have inside of your project. So rather than going and creating a new room and just starting from scratch by drawing new walls, we can make a copy of this room. So again, we talked about things that you can do inside of this project tree, like copying projects, also copying rooms. Now make sure you have that checkbox copy drawing files selected. By doing that, we want to make sure that we're not only copying the data from room one, but also copying the room drawing file. And in here, we can start making some changes to these walls that we already have drawn. Everything's the same inside of this room as it was in the first one. So you'll notice here as we select the prompts, we still have the same information on this wall as we had before, but we can make any changes that we want and it's not going to have any effect on room one. All right, so we don't need all these walls. We're just going to be working with a couple of them inside the quadrant one and quadrant three. So we'll clean up this drawing a little bit, and we're going to use the microvellum erase command. And we'll just go around the drawing and start picking these walls that we want to get rid of from this drawing. After you're done selecting all the walls, right click or enter to finish this command. And you want to make sure that you get that pop-up asking, are you sure you want to erase these selected items? And that's good. We're deleting a microvellum product using a microvellum command. We have those polylines that are still left over. So instead of going into the palette, right, we'll just select the items, hit delete, and get rid of this from our drawing. So we're going to work on that little wall in quadrant one. But before we do that, I just want to change this angle of this wall here just because it's bothering me. So go into the prompts, into our custom tool strip, since that's going to be the way that we access the prompts of these components, and change our right angle to zero. So the idea here is that we had this wall already drawn. You know, we thought it was the right size, everything was ready to go for some cabinets, but we got an email and they sent us a picture and they wanted cabinets that are going to look something like that. So we need to go through and make some changes to this wall. We'll go into the wall options and first change the width. And then in the height, it's only 8 feet, so we can adjust that here. And then of course they sent us that picture, so we know there's a window. So we got to go into the window options, change our window quantity to 1. You can just go through the different options and select the window size. We're going to change that to custom. By doing this, it's going to allow us to change the window width and the window height. Now changing our view, we can go and take a look at this from an isometric view. And now you see our 3D object with the window now cut into it and the window casing applied. Now one thing with the window casing, it's coming from a prompt name called casing selection. And that casing selection is being used on a window and a door. So if we were to change that, see the list of different options that we have, you can turn off the casing altogether and see how it looks like it's just a cutout in the wall now. Or you can go back and select something maybe a little bit more detailed and have that drawn. So, but I just wanted to mention that it does apply for both a window and a door. That wall looks good, it's ready to go. So when we get ready to place some cabinets, we can do that and not have any conflicts with our window. Now moving on to quadrant three. And in this situation, it would have been as if we had gone out to the job site after the fact and realized, you know, maybe they did a couple things that we weren't expecting. So they've added a column on one of the walls and they've added that bulkhead on both of the walls. So let's go back into the prompts. Under the obstructions tab, you can check the box add column. And when you do that, you can see that the more prompts appear and you're ready to start adding this column to the wall. So we're going to enter the distance now to the start of this column. We can double click inside of the cell and that takes us back inside of the drawing. And from there, we can select 2 points that will give us the distance to this column. So what it does, it takes the distance from these two points and it becomes the value for your distance to the column. And now just to confirm that it is in the right spot, we can use our dimension command. So D in the command line, and we can confirm that it is 50 inches. Now, what if we wanted to go back and just make that change? Instead of it being 50 inches from the left-hand side, we'll change it now to 60 inches from the right-hand side. Another way you can pull a dimension instead of using the dimension linear command is by going into the AutoCAD ribbon and then measure. You can select distance and pick two points to give you the distance in X. Now, it'll also give you the distance in Y and Z if there were any. So that could be really helpful when you're trying to pull just a quick dimension. And in case you're wondering, there is a shortcut for that. It's DI in the command line. So now we need to add those two bulkheads. So let's go back into our prompts again. Check the box to add bulkhead. Now we have the option to change the height, the depth, and if there was any space that we needed from the left or the right-hand side, we could enter that value there. But we'll leave both of those at zero and just let this redraw. So we have the bulkhead going all the way across. And you can see here, as we orbit around, a good example of what Toolbox is doing in the background with its data is letting the column know that it needs to decrease in height because there's now been a bulkhead that's added to this wall. Now we'll do the same thing to this return wall, going under the obstructions tab and again, adding that bulkhead. Now this time we do need to give it a distance from the left-hand side. So we're gonna double click again inside of this cell, pick our two points. That's giving us a distance of 12 and redraw. So you can see how that works by double clicking in there, picking two points. It's an easy way just to make sure that you're getting the exact value or dimension that you want. Now in quadrant two, I'm just gonna draw a quick U-shaped polyline and go over some of the things with the adjust wall length command again. Now you don't have to do this, you can just follow along, it'll be really quick. I just wanted to show you one of the differences between using the adjust wall length command with a set of walls like this U-shape here, compared to something that's a closed polyline or four walls all the way around. So you can see this one works the way that we expect it to, very easily, just adjusting the wall size and then moving the wall to the right. But now if we move to quadrant four, let's draw a new set of walls, again, starting from left to right. We'll just make it a square polyline, 150 in each direction, and make sure that we close the polyline at the end. So now that we have this closed polyline, let's add some walls to it and select this polyline path. When we use the adjust wall length on something like this, it does require one additional step. So that was something that we didn't go over in the first video of working with walls and room components. So I just wanted to mention that here. So as we select the first wall and give it a new length, picking our anchor point and then updating that selected wall, you can see that all three of the walls moved. So that's probably not what you want. So you got to make sure you go into the other wall now and do the same thing, adjust that wall length and just make sure that you have the correct anchor point selected. Okay, so let's continue to work on this wall in quadrant four. We'll basically simulate another scenario of having these set of walls that we need to turn into an actual room with some windows, a door, and you can see here they've already gone ahead and added the crown and baseboard for us. So that's great. We'll just have to cut it away when we start putting in some cabinets. But the idea here is just to get familiar with working with these walls again, adding some more obstructions and some windows and doors, and then also how you can add some moldings to your project too. So first off, we're going to start by selecting this one wall and adding the column in the corner. So let's check the box, add column, make sure we're referencing from the right-hand side. Keep the distance at zero, so it'll be placed right at the corner, and we'll update the width and the depth of that column. Now under the window options, we're going to change our window quantity to 2. We'll keep it as a double hung, and so we'll give this a new distance. And you'll notice here now we have the options for window 2. So because we have two windows, obviously we may want it in a different location. So the way that it works is that we get to have options for window 1 and options for window 2. Okay, so that looks good. We got our column, we got our two windows. Now let's just make this a little bit easier to continue finishing up this drawing. We're gonna isolate these objects. So going into the status bar and selecting isolate objects, we want to only see these walls while we're working on this drawing. When you're working in a 3D view like this, it is a good time to actually use that lasso selection. So let's left click and hold it down and create the lasso around these objects. And everything that's inside of this lasso will be isolated. So now moving on to our next wall, we're going to add a big bay window in this one. Now, when we change the window one series, you'll notice that the window sizes also change. So because Toolbox is looking to a different type of window here, it's letting us know that there are different options available for its size, making sure that we do have something selected so it does draw properly. And now make sure that we have the radio button to center the window on the wall and hit OK. Now for the last wall, we just got to add a door. So going into the door options and repeating the steps of going through each one of the prompts and just making sure that we have all the right ones selected. Now the next step in this exercise is to take this room and add some baseboard and crown molding to it from our library. Now maybe you have some of the finished work included in your scope of the project, or you just want to add some extra details to your drawing. Either way, this can be done in Toolbox. So that's what I'm going to show you how to do right now. So first off, let's add it to the drawing, and we're going to make sure that we're in this 2D wireframe view. So we're orbiting around again, just making sure that we have a nice view to work with. And under our draw tab and the draw room components, selecting the moldings drop-down list, see all the different types of moldings that you have available. So similar to drawing walls in your drawing, you're selecting the molding from your list, right-clicking, and picking points to place this molding in the drawing. And then just going around the room and selecting all the different points. And when you're done, hit enter or right-click to finish this command. So now at the end of that, you're getting this pop-up asking what's going to be the height above the floor that the baseboard will be placed. Because it's baseboard, we're just going to keep it at zero. All these moldings are being referenced from the floor, so you'll be asked that every time. And then the three options you have below that add lineal footage to the project. So what this will do is let us know exactly how much overall length we need for this baseboard. This is similar to a wall where it's not a manufacturable product, right? It's not something that we can create code for and send out to the machine to get cut. But one thing different from the wall is that this is something that we can have inside of our list of products that are included in this project. So after we add our crown molding, we'll go into our product list and take a look at that. Now scrolling down and finding CM01 molding, that's our crown. You can see the image of it there, and doing the same thing we just did with our baseboard. Going around the room, selecting all the different points. And then when we're done, hitting enter or right clicking to finish. On this one, we do want to add a height above the floor. So we drew these walls at 108. You can see from the image, it does give us that dimension, which is helpful. So we'll take that 2.5, subtract that from our 108. And let's add 105.5 to this. We'll put a comment in here just so you can see where that comment appears when we open up our product list. And then instead of adding the lineal footage, we'll add each segment. So now we can actually get a quantity of each piece that we need for this crown molding, and it'll tell you what size it needs to be cut at. Let's go back into our microvellum palette and to the project tab. Notice there we have product list. Let's go ahead and select that. So now inside of our product list, you can see that we have those two pieces of molding that we've added to our project. Now inside of this product list would be all the cabinets too. If there were a bunch of cabinets already added to this project, they would also appear in this list. There's that comment that we added, that crown for project. So that's where that comment's going to appear. And because we selected the option to add the lineal footage to the project, you'll see as we open up the parts list of this first molding, the one part that's in there has the part name and the overall length for the entire perimeter of the room. And then selecting the next one, see the crown molding a little bit different. There's the part name. And it's now broken out by each segment, giving us all the pieces that we need with the length of each piece. There's a lot more things that we can do inside of the product list, and that's something that we'll get into in some of the upcoming videos. But for now, I just wanted to show you how you can add some molding to your projects and other things you can do to give you that realistic representation. So I hope that helped you understand a little bit more on some of the things that you can do with room components inside of your project. Stay tuned for our next video, where we're going to continue to learn more about Toolbox.